Thank you and welcome to the third part of the afternoon, of the day. It is titled, The Archaeological Dead in the Contemporary Society. This session is opened by Chiara Bolchini, speaking about the visual use of human remains in the archaeological publications.
Thank you, Cam. Hi, everyone. Now let's try to find out how it works. Okay. So today I will talk about the use of photographs in archaeological publication. And to do so, I looked at three different journals. We'll start from thinking about why we use photographs and why. And then we discuss why photographs have been used in the publication that have been looked at. So, firstly, photographs are the most direct way we have to show death and to show how what death looks like and how people in the past used to deal with it. Images communicate a message themselves, and it can be very self-explanatory, even more than words. Photographs can transmit strong messages and can impact to an emotional level as well. So the reason why we like photographs and the reason why we don't really like them. So we like them because it's kind of the only way we have to look at death and what that looks like, and it's kind of fascinating and interesting. It can be considered human remains and like death in general, well, not in general, but within archaeology, is kind of considered the emblem of archaeology itself. And we don't mind looking at them because we feel like they're from the past, so they don't relate to us anymore. We are alive, they're dead, we're kind of detached from it. And well, they're incredibly useful for teaching. We don't really like photographs when we realize that they can be too realistic or disturbing, and when we realize that that's us in a few years, hopefully. And it's a reminder that we will all die. Very cheerful, sorry. And yeah, we also don't like them when they touch our emotional sphere. And when, yeah. So, oh, and we don't use them when they're not relevant to the paper. To the paper. So, my research, I analyzed three different journals, the World Archaeology Journal, Antiquity Journal, and Current Archaeology Journal. And I primarily looked at the proportion of papers with pictures of human remains within the journal, the presence of articles about human remains with no photographs, the number of photographs that are inserted in the papers, and which the type of photographs that I used and their purposes. So the first one, I've analyzed 3 years of issues. That sounds like my uni life. So from 2015 to 2013. So there were 15 issues in total. So in 2015, the total papers in the journal were 48, and there were none about human remains whatsoever. In 2014, there were a total of 53 papers. And again, there was one about human remains with, the HR plus P means human remains with pictures, with photographs. With one articulated, a photograph of an articulated skeleton. But there were two other papers with no pictures at all. In 2013, they published 48 papers, and there were two articles with human remains and pictures, again, two articulated bodies, but five with no images at all. And then I will discuss this later. So, Antiquity Journal, I've analyzed 2 years of issues from 2015 and 2014. So I've analyzed a total of 12 issues. And in 2015, the paper published were 115, and 14 of them were about human remains with pictures, and just 2 of them were about human remains with no pictures. And we can see that 36 pictures were again articulated human remains, and 5, just 5, were disarticulated. 2014, 140 papers in total, 7 with about human remains with picture, none about human remains with no pictures, and again they were all articulated skeletons. Current Archaeology Journal, 2 years of issues analyzed. Again, I'm not going to say all the numbers. I'm just going to say that the total photographs, the total photographs were like all about articulated bodies. And in 2015, just 1 was about disarticulated. And in 2014, were like 38 pictures all of articulated skeletons and no disarticulated one. Well, that's not really the conclusion, but what I wanted to say is that what we can see from all those numbers, there are like a great number of pictures of photographs that we use in journal articles. Almost all of them are about something visually appealing, like a skeleton, like a human body, like something that we can recognize. And there's not that much focus on what is just a bit of broken bone here and there, really. And I've also found out that the reason why, I think is, yeah, in this journal, there are a few papers, 7 papers in 2 years, about human remains with no pictures, which can be, it's a bit unusual. And they were usually papers about sensitive issues like repatriations or a very specific type of bug bodies that has been discussed for a long time. And in that paper, they were just going over it again with deciding not to use any pictures. And the other interesting element was that within the 78 papers from the journals, 17 photographs of human remains were taken with the archaeologists in action. So you actually see the whole skeleton and like the archaeologists kind of posing, waiting for the shot to be taken. Well, this is just to say that dead are not treated equally, even when published and photographed, and they're used as an emblem of archaeology itself, hence why 17 photographs were taken with the actual archaeologist that was pretending to dig them up. And I know this is just a small number of papers that have been tested, so tested. And there's still a lot of research that can be done to see how photographs of human remains are actually used. There's like the whole internet and blog world that needs to be explored, and many other issues. But yeah, that's what I did today.
Hello, how are you? I'm Brian Costello. I'm filling in for Dan today. We're going to be talking about absence and fragmentation. So basically, I'd like to start off is this is going to be about telling a story when there is no body. A lot of archaeology, we'll be talking about mortuary archaeology. You're always telling the story through the body, osteology through the bones, the story of how it is. But what happens when there is no body? There's only a piece of a body. One of my favorite Shakespeareans is Hamlet, and my favorite scene in that is there's a grave being dug by a gravedigger. Hamlet's just returning, and they're chatting back and forth, and he picks up the skull, and he says, "Who's this?" And it's the old jester that he used to know as a kid. It's the last poor Yorick. I knew him once. Man of most infinite fancy, most magnificent jest. I got that backwards, but still, it's been real rusty. But through that, he told a whole story of how he knew this one man through just a skull. And he told a story, and through that time period, it's basically telling through nothing and conveying to the people that were there the story of this one man when he's not there anymore. His grave's been already dug up and someone else is going in. And through this, one of the most iconic ones, the Sutton Hoo burial, the Sutton Hoo landscape, where we have a whole landscape of burials and really no bodies that are left. Through the excavation, we only have the shadows of the human remains. And this is one of the most famous ones, and it's very iconic, and it's been played through contemporary culture of our times. Even when I was in elementary school, we knew about the Sutton Hoo burial in America. Yes, I'm not really born and raised Cheshire, if you can't tell. But it's been there, and all the material culture, everything that was in the burial, the Sutton Hoo ship burial, is really easily, that it told the story from back then of who or what this man is idealized as, what they want him to be known as without the body being there. So you can see here, there's a makeup, the Mound 1 Sutton Hoo grave reconstruction after Martin Carver in 2005. Basically, you have the inside the boat, you have where the body would be, or where it was, where the stain was. There's weaponry, shield, the hammer, the helmet, the sword, the bowls. He had things from all over. He had things from Francia, the Germanic lands, the Byzantine. Everywhere came. There was things from everywhere. It showed that it wasn't just a local guy. He was very a man of the world, or at least the trade said so. He had the money to do so. At least that's what they portrayed him as. And he's buried in a boat. And this is a time period when this is going on. This is the early 7th century, late 6th century. So when you're looking at this, this is a time period in Anglo-Saxon England where there's social stratification going on. There's changing of religions going on. Grave and mortuary culture is changing dramatically. It's going from a lot of grave goods and portraying identity to no grave goods at all in Christianity, where there's really nothing to be told by. And here's a man buried with immense wealth. Not only that, but probably the richest grave in England at the time that we've found so far. So you can see this, the things all the way around, the shield, and you see the reconstructions, what they've made. It's all gold, gilded, garnet. Everything is the richest, the most fantastic you can have at the time. There we go. And there's the helmet right there. From this is the landscape. All these burials, cremations, robbed cremations, inhumations, children's graves, other ship burials around the area. It's just a landscape where no bodies, you can't tell anything from the bodies, the human remains. Only the shades that have been excavated. So here's the ship again. Cemetery, like I said before, early 7th, late 6th, Mound 1. It was an entire ship created. And where this is on top of this hill. So to get it there, create the boat there, it is at the precipice. It is at the top. It looks down on everybody where the civilization was. And to bury the ship takes immense effort. First of all, you're making the ship, and then you're burying it. What I loved is when they recreated the ship in contemporary times to see how it sailed. I think it sunk on its maiden voyage, I'm pretty sure, which shows you maybe it was only for the grave, not really seaworthy. But through this, the material culture of this, that's how we tell the story. That's the story we learn about what we think is King Raedwald. That's the identity given to him, is that king of East Anglia at that time period. And through the helmet, specifically, which we've just seen, I think, well, we'll go back real quick. Through this helmet, that's the face of the man we think. That when you think Sutton Hoo, that's what everybody knows. The helmet. The crown, as some people say. And this helmet itself, the recreation of, is so much about it that it could tell us. For one, in one eyebrow with the garnets, you can see right here, there would be garnets all the way throughout there. On the left eye, the gold foil behind has been taken out in Paul Mortimer's work, who found this out. So it shows that it's darker on one side, going back to their, you could say, pagan beliefs of the Woden, the cult of Woden, everything on that sort of nature. And of course, gilded and gold, garnets everywhere, eyes, the style of art, the anthropomorphic features of it. So, recreating now, we have illustrations to show basically the mortuary ritual, how we interpret how it was. You have everybody, the boat's been built, everybody comes to the funeral, the body's inside. And they're basically wowed by all the gold, the gilt, how it is, the ship. This man was the man. He was the king. He has everything in there, all the artwork, the gold, you know, at this time period, that really, for social stratification, making of kingdoms and everything, that would have a big impact on not only after he's gone, but the people that take over after him. Again, another recreation of what it would look like if we were there, or what it would look like at the time. You have the body in, blankets, the helmet nearby, the sword on the right, shielded bomb, and also the axe hammer. The king himself. This is in the museum, right now, the British Museum. It's there. All across the world who know about the Sutton Hoo, this is what they think of, the story of the helmet, the story of the man who wore the helmet. And now, for the rest of the landscape, we have deviant burials. Of course, no bodies, but through the excavation, we find their imprint, their shadow remains. And from this, we can learn the story of them. So not only just kings and through material culture, but how they were. We find that the head is not on the body. It's cut off, sometimes between the leg, sometimes on the side. These are all in area or in twisted positions as so. Through this, there's story of these people. Why are they like that? Were they criminals? Why were they killed like this? Why were they buried like this out of the mortuary fashion of the time? And here's a recreation of the helmet. You can see one more time how glamorous it would have been. Silver plated, gold everywhere, garnets throughout. So no body was fine, attributed to King Raedwald, as I said before. And another burial under Mound 17, it was a horse and weapon, which is a very male upper class thing to be buried with. There's a horse burial nearby, weapon burials, of course, specifically swords, gave a lot of prestige to the burial. One disturbed female inhumation grave under Mound 14, cremation burials and other mounds mostly robbed. And where are these people? Of course, the acidic soil destroyed them, especially there's other cemeteries nearby, Snape, where there's another boat burial. Really can't tell, we think he's a young adult buried with a sword in a boat, but we can't tell. So they're gone, but the material culture and basically what remains, their shadow, can still tell a story. And that's all that. Thank you very much, appreciate it.
Today, I'm going to be talking to you about the repatriation of human remains to Aboriginal communities in Australia and how this modern day issue has changed over the course of a couple of decades in archaeology. Repatriation, in the broadest terms, is simply giving something back. This can often be returning cultural objects of any description to returning the dead to their modern day ancestors or places of origin. But are there some examples of this that are perhaps inappropriate repatriation? Is it always the right thing to do? I'll be looking to see whether there is any pros or cons in repatriation. Some of these issues came about during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. A large quantity of items and human remains were possessed from indigenous communities and sold to people around the world. The selling of such objects are still auctioned across the internet today. Controlling our own cultural heritage is something that is not only important to us, but arguably to most people. Aborigines reinstating control over their cultural heritage is a primary reason for confronting these issues. The controversy derives from the belief that it is disrespectful to the dead and to their contemporary descendants for the remains to be displayed in a museum or stored. There are also other beliefs that should be acknowledged. For example, within certain indigenous populations, there is a belief that the spirits of the dead cannot rest until the body is returned to that country. What is seen today is very different to what was seen 20 years ago. There was a major opposition to repatriation by heritage professionals, many whom worked in Australian Museum. They believed that repatriation was the wrong thing to do and would be surrendering to indigenous political activism. The relationships between the indigenous people and the community has developed since. Both political and social rights have been given to or won by indigenous people across a broad range of areas, from land rights to the acknowledgement that Aboriginal people were and are the original owners of Australian land. In the 1990s, indigenous ownership and rights were recognised, which led to notable changes in archaeological ethical standards. Conferences holding debates on repatriation The transformation of heritage legislation reflected changes in practice, which led to change in direction for archaeology. For example, the National Museum of Australia established a repatriation unit in 2000. One of the major turning points was the return of the remains of Mungo Lady in 1992, who lived around 42,000 years ago and is an example of one of the oldest cremations in the world and one of the most iconic burials in Australian history. The return of Mungo Lady was honoured with a large ceremony that drew together many Indigenous communities. Australian museums return remains because debates and engagement with Aboriginal peoples have convinced the industry that this is the ethical course of action. The National Museum of Australia has been returning remains and objects since 1980 and is recognised worldwide for its repatriation work. More than 1,000 individuals have unconditionally been returned to Indigenous communities. In comparison to museums in other countries, such as the Natural History Museum in Britain, which has over 6,000 Indigenous Australian items that have been acquired after British contact and occupation of Australia. However, some Indigenous Australians insist that the British Museum has preserved these items that would otherwise have been lost. Is this preservation or plunder? There are many ways to this issue can be interpreted. It is without doubt that these items have derived from sometimes aggressive plundering, but could be argued now serve as an important educational tool that give insight into different cultures. On the other hand, repatriation is very symbolic to the Aboriginal community because it shows growing equality in Australia, which is very important. Now to go back to Mungo Lady. A very similar case is the case of Mungo Man, who wasn't returned at the same time, and his remains were held up until 2015. So it is only recently that these remains have been given back to the Aboriginal communities. Does anybody have the right to claim ancestry to the remains of humans that are as old as 42,000 years? In some cases, is repatriation always the right thing to do? Should there be a line between remains found archaeologically and those remains stolen in 19th and 20th centuries? There are also a number of issues that have to be overcome if repatriation takes place. Individual communities have different views of what is culturally appropriate and respectful. Options including a keeping place or a cultural centre in which to house the return property prior to reburial. There are also issues of funding and museum curation capacity. Community decisions can take time. For example, Indigenous communities in Western Australia took 5 years to determine their aspirations, needs and protocols for repatriation from various Australian museums. The question of whether to rebury remains have also been a problem, as there is no consistent policy on the status of reburials. Whether they should be protected under cemetery legislation or as heritage sites, though in 2005, the New South Wales government declared 7 new sites within parks and reserves for the reburial of Aboriginal remains. So, to summarise, repatriation is a very important and sensitive topic that is extremely important to communities in Australia. Without a doubt, looted remains should be given back to those that were stolen from, and we are seeing that this is happening today. However, in the case of Mungo man and woman, there is more of an argument for these remains to be held in a museum because they serve as important learning tools. Is 40,000 years a long time, or perhaps too long for anybody to lay claim to? That's it.
Almost all of the discussions of mortuary archaeology's relationship to contemporary society in recent years have focused very much on the complex, contentious issues that we've just been hearing about from Ross, to do with repatriation and the reburial of remains that are claimed as ancestral to Indigenous communities around the world. And in particular, the focus has been on Australasia and the Americas. More recently, there has been attention to the situation in the UK, and within the last decade, we've seen what has been described as a crisis in burial archaeology, as museum curators and our field archaeologists find themselves on shifting sands in a debate about how it is best to dig up, to display and curate human remains and artefacts from mortuary contexts. And we have seen a crisis over the interpretation of burial law that saw me as one of 50 professors writing an open letter complaining, if you like, or disputing the government Ministry of Justice's desire for all human remains to be reinterred rapidly after excavation. And we have seen a series of repatriations of material from British museums and redisplays of material from British museums that has taken many human remains off display or into more sensitive, one could argue, or more concealed places within museums. Now, 5 years ago, actually 6 years ago, Mel Giles of Manchester University and myself and I organised two sessions, one at the then Institute for Archaeologist Conference, now the CIFA, Chartered Institute for Archaeologists, their annual conference at Stockport, and a session at the Theoretical Archaeology Group Conference to bring together British and European archaeologists to try and redress the imbalance away from colonial situations to address British and European context. And it's taken a long process of peer review, and our book is finally coming out with Oxford University Press, probably in late May, early June, and we've called it Archaeologists and the Dead. And in this book, which will be too expensive for anyone to actually buy, but it will appear in libraries, but that's true of all big academic publications, we have 19 chapters, an introduction, so 20 chapters in total, that explore a range of very different ways in which mortuary archaeology relates to contemporary society. Ways in which issues and themes that may have been neglected in the recent literature focusing on display and storage of human remains, and in particular on the repatriation and reburial debate. One of the key areas the book addresses is how we deal with human remains in the field. The investigation of whether through survey, prospective techniques, or through actual excavation of funerary remains, how do we engage the public in these processes? Do we retain these remains concealed as Ministry of Justice's human remains licences stipulate behind shielding so the public can't see them? And then immediately publish the photographs online for millions of people of those same skeletons? Or do we realise, as Duncan Sayer has been strongly advocating, and indeed his paper in our book suggests, that we should make the excavations fully open and engage people in a careful and nuanced way with why we're digging up the dead, how we're digging up the dead, and what we hope to achieve through this process in terms of new scientific information, new cultural information, and in terms of engaging people with broader issues outside of archaeology to do with mortality. The two photographs here are taken from articles in the book. One on the left is excavations by Tim Malin and Cambridgeshire Archaeological Unit in the 1990s of an Anglo-Saxon skeleton in Cambridgeshire, and showing how they were, should we say, subverting the licence regulations in having skeletons on display, and good for them. The one on the right is another interesting case study from the book, and it's from the mid-Atlantic island of St. Helena. And here, a very interesting case study in the book is looking at the excavation of a freed slave cemetery. These are individuals of African descent who were taken to St. Helena after being liberated by the British Navy from slaving ships after the British Empire's banning of the slave trade. And most of them were obviously in a poor condition and died in the mid-Atlantic. And the awkwardness of this situation is that local people in their local story, do not see themselves as descendants of African slaves. They are descendants of colonists from a range of other locations in the Indian Ocean and around the Atlantic. And here these people haven't even met, the skeletons themselves never got to the New World, so they can't be claimed as ancestors of modern North American black communities, for example. They are literally in life and death in between. They're not in Africa, they're not in the New World. And so we have the excavation of remains that are connected into a global set of politics and cultural affinities, and yet are almost forgotten as a result, and the archaeological work there brings them to life. We have complex examples where excavation is linked to national and international politics, and I've even though I've read and reread the example in the book of the excavation of Oseberg in Norway of a Viking Age burial, I still get confused about exactly when these bones were dug up, when they were reburied, when they were dug up again, and what on earth is going on with them. And here, and so we have burials that are constantly shifting in their significance in contemporary culture and politics through their examination and their display, but also their re-evaluation and sometimes reburial. Many of the articles, and we'll hear about more about this from Ingmarie, will be looking at issues of display in the museums. Individual bodies that are presented, how they're presented, how their presentation has changed through time, and how they tell us about the past, but also reveal much about our changing attitudes to death and society. Not only skeletons and bog bodies, where the immediacy of looking on the face of the dead, as I think we'll be hearing about later, is such a powerful, evocative, iconic aspect of funerary remains. And bog bodies have a special place in our cultural imagination of the ancient dead. And indeed, Mel Giles, my co-editor, has a book forthcoming looking at bog bodies, what they tell us about the past, but also how they fit into our modern culture. And also, one of the key issues of the book is to look at the diversity of the human dead in museums and in our cultural world today. How archaeology is, and archaeologists as interlopers into graves, as we heard about from Harry and others, are part of our popular culture. But also, in museums, when we discuss museum displays of the human dead, most of our attention has focused almost exclusively on mummies, bog bodies, and articulated remains. And Chiara's study showed that very clearly in terms of the popular expectation to see an articulated body. And yet, of course, most of the remains in our stores, in museums, and most of the remains on display in the museums are fragmented and often burnt. And my case study in the book focuses in particular on cremated human remains. And of all of the previous studies, no one has looked at the cremated dead and how they're treated and displayed in museums, despite the fact that some of the most important global examples of ancient human remains, as we heard from Ross with Mungo Lady, are cremations, the cremations from the Aubrey Holes at Stonehenge. And this is just a humble example from the Iron Age of southern Jutland in a museum in Haderslev in Denmark. Just to make the point that the cremated dead are so much more difficult to apprehend as human. And yet, the choices we make about how we display them and the stories we tell about the cremation process and the identities of the individuals we can discern from the bones and the objects reveal a lot about our relationships to the dead, the challenge of looking at fragmentation, but also the fact that we are, all in Northern Europe in particular, including Britain, we are a cremating society. 80% or so of Britons will be burnt after they die. And therefore, the way we discuss and treat ancient cremation reveals a lot and has a lot of importance for how we encounter our own mortality. So there's some key issues. Can we simply focus, when we think about the relationship of mortuary archaeology to contemporary society, as many of the talks have shown already today, and I'm sure more will come, Can we talk simply about the challenge of looking at human remains and reburial and repatriation, or is there a broader set of debates to be had that we might call public mortuary archaeology? And that's what my book with Mel is trying to pose, that question. Should we be broadening out our debate beyond bones and beyond museums to think about a range of other ways in which we are, as archaeologists, death dealers? We are dealing with and talking about and interpreting mortality in the past and present. Can we develop new ways of investigating mortality in the past, thinking about dying and death, including disability, as Rebecca's paper was discussing? New ways of talking and writing about the dead beyond the conventional ways of describing graves and discussing funerary remains. Can we think of new strategies for visualising the dead? And Mel's paper in the book talks in particular about visualising funerals, and we've seen some artists' reconstructions of funerary events already today. And in particular, with the digital revolution, does the digital world, as Rachel's paper was making clear, can the digital world give us new opportunities and new challenges of when it is appropriate to visualise the dead, to write about the dead, bearing in mind in the digital world, we cannot control the audience that will be receiving it. We're writing globally, we're writing for everyone, and therefore we have a new set of issues about when we choose to photograph, visualise gravestones, artefacts from graves, or indeed the human bodies themselves. So that's really just a shameless plug, really.
Thank you.